Okay, thanks. We'll make a start. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners and custodians of the land on which we meet today, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and pay my respects to their elders past and present, and the elders from other communities who may be here today. It's a great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Daniel Cameron. He's a PhD student in my lab, co-supervised by Terry Speed, and this is his completion seminar. Daniel's background is in mathematics and software engineering, and he actually has some unique experience, 11 years of experience as a software engineer before he started his PhD. His project is a really fantastic example of a bioinformatics PhD project, I think. His aim was to improve some methods, some bioinformatics methods, that we wanted to use in tumour sequencing data and also in other diseases. And then apply these to some biological problems that we were working on. But this is his project is really a discovery project. The thing that he's discovering is how to do bioinformatics better. So from our previous work on cancer genomes, looking at neochromosomes in sarcomas, as well as developing methods for calling chromosomal rearrangements in tumours, we come up with a bunch of ideas or principles or hypotheses about how to do it better. And Daniel undertook really extensive testing using computation to figure this out. He refined some of our ideas, he rejected some of them outright, and he came up with his own hypotheses. You can see from his title, using genome assembly to dramatically improve the identification of chromosomal rearrangements in sequencing data, that the result of his experimentation is some kind of dramatic change, a big improvement. His work involved lots of wrong turns, but the eventual rediscovery of a really unusual assembly algorithm that has helped chromosome rearrangement discovery enormously. And his method has won an international bake-off between different methods where people submit their favourite method that they're developing to this challenge, and then the methods are baked off against each other, and some method comes out on top. Daniel's won this international competition. As you're going to hear, he's now starting to apply his method to biological research problems, and he's already generating new insights into neochromosomes, which we work on in the lab, and started to translate his tool for use in the clinic. Please join me in welcoming Daniel.
Thanks for that, Tony, even though you've already revealed some of my punchlines of my talk. All right. So if we're talking about chromosomal rearrangements, what rearrangements is it that we're talking about? Now, the database of genomic variation, which is a curated catalogue of human genomic structural variation, defines it as a genomic alteration that involves segments of DNA larger than 50 base pairs. So essentially, if it's really small localized change, then we say, yeah, this isn't a structural variation. For the purpose of this talk, I'm just going to consider a chromosomal rearrangement and a structural variation to be synonymous terms, so they maybe get used interchangeably. In terms of classification of these rearrangements, you have your simple rearrangements, such as your deletion, duplication, inversion, insert, translocations. They're relatively straightforward kind of changes. But within cancer, the landscape is much more complicated and diverse. You end up with very complex rearrangements. You end up with neochromosomes, so new chromosomes, which can either be linear, circular, very large, very small. You have some mechanisms that haven't been fully worked out how they actually function, such as chromothripsis, where it appears that your chromosome gets shattered into hundreds and hundreds of fragments, and then the repair mechanism tries its best to put it back together. You have chromoplexy, which is you have these weird chromosomes made of a whole bunch of them, and then you have breakage fusion bridge, where you have these specific regions that end up very highly amplified. So, generally, why do we care about these rearrangements? So, they're associated with a large number of genetic disorders. So one of the main ones would be trisomy 23, which is associated, which causes Down syndrome. You have smaller rearrangements, such as Williams syndrome, caused by deletion of about 1.6 megabases, or 26 genes, on chromosome 7. And then you have these small rearrangements, like the major cause of Duchenne muscular dystrophy is just exon duplication or deletion within the within the dystrophin gene. So you have this very wide range of changes. Within the cancer context, you can have these rearrangements actually driving the cancer, which probably the most well known would be the Philadelphia chromosome, which found translocation between chromosome 9 and 22, resulting in a fusion gene, which is the driver mutation in the cancer, and it's found in about 95% of CML. These fusion genes can actually some are clinically relevant, and there have been drugs targeting specifically these fusion genes. So, given that these things are important, we want to know more about them, how do we actually go about identifying them? So, techniques have been around for 60 years. Your traditional cytogenetic techniques, such as chiasma banding, where for the very large-scale rearrangements, such as the giant neochromosome or a circular chromosome or maybe the double minute chromosome that you can't directly see, but it's got a little arrow next to it, you can these techniques can resolve these large-scale changes, but if it's under about a 10 megabase, you can't really see much. Improved techniques such as fluorescent in situ hybridization or FISH can resolve it down to about three megabase. And now this is actually a multiplex FISH image, a spectral karyotype of a well-differentiated liposarcoma. In a normal genome, each of the human chromosomes would all be stained with a nice different colour. In this case, the stainings should all be there, but as you can see, the actual genome within the cancer is very, very different to to a germline. You've got aneuploidy, heaps of chromosomes with extra copies, missing copies. You've got a whole bunch of chromosomes which you can't really map back to any one chromosome because they don't really correspond to your traditional classification of a chromosome. Now, if you want higher resolution to work out, well, what's actually happening here, what's actually driving this cancer, you could turn to microarrays. So both array compatible hybridization and SNP arrays can give you higher resolution. So they'll be able to tell you which of these oncogenes are actually highly amplified, which tumor suppressors have been lost. Now, the resolution of the microarrays varies from about 100 kilobase all down to about 1 kilobase for the high density arrays. And that tells us a lot of new and interesting information, but it doesn't tell you where these extra copies are located. You have your gain or loss, you don't know if that's in a new circular chromosome or it's just a tandem duplication of this gene. It also won't tell you about copy number neutral events. So if you have a translocation or an inversion, so this technique won't tell you about your Philadelphia chromosome because you've got the same copy number everywhere. So your ideal world where you get single nucleotide resolution of all the changes would be sequencing. Now, in theory, sequencing can if you've got perfect sequencing, you can detect everything. We're not quite there yet. We can detect a lot of interesting changes, but both the techniques and the bioinformatic methods to process it means that we don't quite get everything. Now, what we do have, unlike the previous techniques, we can actually tell where these rearrangement breakpoints are located. Now, this is actually a plot of one of those giant neochromosomes I showed you from the FISH slide. That's the number of breakpoints in that one neochromosome. It's all over the place. It's pretty messed up. So in the case of cancers with structural instability, the environment can be extremely complicated. Now, so to give you an idea of how this works, we need to actually delve into the details of how sequencing works, and then from there I'll give you an idea of what it is that I've done to improve on the existing techniques. So, at a very high level, high throughput sequencing workflow goes something like this. You take your DNA, you extract your DNA. You then fragment your DNA into small fragments. Each of them are about 300 base pairs long. Then you feed that to your magical sequencing machine, and then it spits out a whole lot of data. Now, what the data it spits out is, it kind of looks like this. So for each of those fragments, you'll have a read. Your typical sequences will be 100 base pair reads, where you have a read from one end of the fragment, which will be paired with another read which actually came from the other end of that same fragment. So you've got 200 base pairs of sequence from each of these fragments. And you have, for if you're doing a whole genome sequencing at human scale, you actually have a billion of these fragments. And so that's enough to cover each location in the genome on average about 60 times. But the problem with this data is it's really hard to analyze. You got 2 billion reads and you have no idea where these came from in the genome. Now, in the case of human and mouse and model organisms we've been working with, you actually have a reference genome. So what you can do is you can align these reads to the reference genome to work out where they came from. So in this little example I've got here, you say, hey, all right, here's our first fragment. We say, all right, we've aligned one there and one there. That's about right. Those two are about right. This one's a little interesting because we placed them, but the fragment size is a bit larger than we would expect. So maybe there's something going on here. Again, you can align it in some cases. Well, we can only align some of the bases to this read. So, well, maybe there was an error in the chemistry and you have a chimeric read, or maybe there's actually some sort of breakpoint right at that position. Then if you continue, you line them all, you'll get something that looks vaguely like this. And then you go, all right, well, how do we actually interpret this? So there's two main approaches for detecting the rearrangements in this sort of data. The first is to look at the copy number variation. So you can say, well, if we've got lots of reads at one end of the chromosome and then it suddenly jumps up, that looks like it's a duplication. So you apply the same analytical techniques used in microarrays to the sequencing data, and you can infer the gain or loss of segments of the DNA. Now, this has the same detection capability as your microarrays, and as a result, it shares the same advantages and drawbacks that you have in your microarray analysis. You're unable to detect the breakpoint locations exactly. You're unable to tell which segment of DNA is connected to which other segment of DNA, and you're going to lose all the events that don't cause a change in copy number or allele frequency. So, second approach you can take is to use the actual alignment of the reads to try and actually detect the breakpoints. So instead of looking at trying to find which segments of DNA have been amplified or translocated, you actually say, all right, let's just ignore the segments, let's look at the breakpoints and the adjacencies between the segments. So if you, for example, have a fusion between chromosome A and B, if you've got enough sequencing depth, statistically, you're probably going to have some fragments that actually span across that breakpoint between the two segments. Now, if you align those reads back to your reference genome, you'll have one read aligning to chromosome A and the other aligning to chromosome B. And so these discordant read pairs, if you find clusters of these in your data and you have 100 of these all located all in similar regions, that provides strong evidence that there's actually a breakpoint between chromosome A and B and they're adjacent at that location. Now, since the breakpoint location is somewhere in the unsequenced portion of the fragment, you're not actually going to get exact breakpoint locations, so you're not won't actually be able to tell what the exact sequence of the fusion product is. To be able to tell the exact sequence, then you're going to have to rely on reads that actually overlap the actual breakpoint location. And there's two classifications of these sort of reads. You firstly have these sort of split reads, which are split across both the chromosomes. The first one is your soft clip read, where your aligner has managed to align part of the read to one location, but it doesn't fully align there. So in this case, you'll have it lined chromosome A. So to try and find your breakpoint, what you would do is you would take the bases that didn't align to chromosome A and try and work out where they go. And if you can align them to chromosome B, you've got a nice signal, strong signal indicating that chromosome A and B are adjacent at exactly that location. The other approach, if your aligner aligns all bases in the read, then you have one read mapped, and the one that actually spans the breakpoint will be completely unmapped. So it's a little more complicated to try and work out the breakpoint from this. Firstly, you have to try and place part of the read where you would expect it to be based on the fragment size distribution, so it's going to be nearby the read that's actually mapped. And then you take the remainder of the read, and then you try and map it elsewhere in the genome. Now, if the reads are short, then it's going to be very difficult to map these, and frequently you won't actually be able to get a mapping to both A and B, so you won't actually be able to tell where the... So you'll essentially lose these reads when you're doing your split read analysis. Now, another approach when you have short reads to try and actually improve your mapping is to actually perform genome assembly. So instead of doing your read alignment, you just take all your reads and you say, which reads are very similar to other reads, which reads overlap, and then you try and merge them together into long synthetic reads that we label as contigs. And then we take these contigs, we align these contigs back to our reference genome, and then we do the same sort of split read analysis to identify where the breakpoints are. But since our contigs are much longer than our reads, so if you've got 100 base pair reads, you can have 800 base pairs or 5 kilobase long contigs, you'll be able to place them much better in regions where your genome has some repetitive content in it. Now, the approach I've developed actually combines aspects of all these breakpoint detection methods. So, stepping back a bit, so the first question you'd probably ask is, hasn't this actually been solved? Aren't there tools out there to do this? Well, the answer is yes, there's tools out there to do this. There are a lot of tools out there to do this. The early ones generally relied on one method, so they either looked at the discordant pairs, they looked at the unmapped mates, or maybe the soft clips, and inferred and called the breakpoints just from those. The later methods generally started combining, for example, both discordant pair and split read analysis. But I spent the first 6 months of my PhD performing benchmarking on mostly on the left-hand side of this, because it's taken years to actually do this work. And there were serious drawbacks between all of the tools. Now, the drawbacks for each of the tools were different for each of the tools, but there was no one tool that you say, well, yes, this is actually clearly better than all the other tools. So I said, all right, how do we actually improve on these? So first thing you wanted to do was you needed to detect all the event types. A lot of the tools would just say called deletions insertions, or deletions only, or deletions and inversions, or deletions and translocations. And for tools that could only call deletions, if there was a translocation, it ignored half the evidence for the translocation and said, well, this bit maps to this bit, oh, that's a deletion. And then suddenly, instead of saying there's a translocation of this mobile element from one end of the chromosome to the other, it says, most of your chromosome's been deleted. Even though you look at the copy number analysis, the chromosome is quite clearly still there. So the approach that we took was said, all right, let's just detect the breakpoints directly. Let's not try and say whether this is a deletion or not. That'll actually depend on your copy number and what other breakpoints are around, because as Tony's mentioned, and you've seen from some of the data we're working with is extremely complicated, and there's hundreds and hundreds of breakpoints altogether, so they don't fit into the neat classifications of events. So we'll just call the breakpoints and then work out how to classify them later. We also need to account for microhomology and non-templated sequence. So if you have a poly-A run on one chromosome and you fuse it with a poly-A run on the other chromosome, where the exact breakpoint was located, you can't actually tell, because it's A's on one side and A's on the other, and there's many possible breakpoint positions that are consistent with that same result and sequence. So in developing your caller, you actually have to account for that in your clustering and identification process, because otherwise you look like you've got multiple different breakpoints there. Similarly, you actually have to take into account an untemplated sequence that have been inserted into the breakpoint that doesn't actually match either side. You want high specificity, so you want to make the best use of all the available evidence. You want to chuck out as little as possible. Anything that looks like it could possibly indicate some sort of rearrangement, you want to somehow take into account and incorporate into your intercaller. You want high specificity. If you've got working in the clinical setting, there's no point in giving a clinician saying, here's a cancer, there's 50,000 breakpoints in here and 2% of these will be correct. That's not useful to the clinician. They want their nice set of, here are the 100 breakpoints, these are the ones that are clinically relevant, and of these 100 breakpoints, we're 98 or 95% confident that these are correct. You need to be computationally efficient. If your tool takes 180 days to run, even if it's a really good tool, even if you get good results, it's not a good tool. And yes, I have run some tools for 180 days and decided this isn't going to finish. I will kill it now. You also want high-quality software. You want it well-tested. You want it well-documented so people can actually use it and understand the output. You want it to not crash, which sounds very simple, but turns out there's a lot of bioinformatics software that just crashes. You also want your software to be able to run and give meaning results on the full range of data that it's likely to encounter. So, to do this, we wrote grids. So, at a very high level, we have three different components. The first thing is we say, all right, if we have reads or read pairs that perfectly match to the reference genome and the two reads are placed about the distance apart that we would expect based on the fragment size of our library, that's not interesting to us. So we'll just chuck those out. So that chucks out about 90% of the reads from your sequencing data. What you're left with is the discordantly paired reads, the reads with unmarked rates, the partially aligned reads with soft clips in them, the reads that align that have an insertion or a deletion within the read alignment themselves. We identify the discordant read pairs, identify the split reads from the soft clips and the unmapped mates. Then we try and assemble all the breakpoint contigs, because in theory, what we're just left with is all these reads that possibly span two different DNA segments with a breakpoint in the middle. So we want to assemble, try and find all the sequences for these putative breakpoints, and then we combine our discordant read pairs, our split reads, and our assembly contig in some sort of probabilistic variant calling model that will output, yes, these are high confidence calls, we like these, and these are pretty low confidence calls, there wasn't much coverage there, there's not much there, or maybe there's a lot of noise, we're not confident in there, but it could be relevant. So, the key interesting part of what we've done is actually in this assembly process. So what we did, we said, well, right, we don't want to throw out information. Our reads have already been aligned to the reference genome, and the reference genome contains a lot of repeats, and a lot of those have been resolved, and yes, the repeats have very similar sequence, but if we can incorporate that read alignment into our assembly process, that actually gives us some really good information that you wouldn't get if you just did de novo assembly without a reference. So our first attempt was we said, all right, let's take every single position in the genome and say, let's try and assemble the contig based on all the reads that kind of imply there could be some sort of breakpoint at this location. So that kind of worked, but the problem was those discordant read pairs and the reads that are unmapped and have only mapped of one read of the pair actually support a breakpoint position over a number of bases. So anywhere in that fragment, you said, yeah, there could be a breakpoint there. So what we ended up with is a whole lot of similar contigs, all containing very similar sets of reads with one more and one less and one more and one less. And well, that's problematic. So, all right, we need to fix this. So then we said, all right, how about we just take small windows on our genome? Instead of going at single base pair, let's just expand it and say, all right, anything within, say, 200 bases of this location, we'll try and assemble that. And then we'll move a little further along and 200 base pairs at this location. And so that improved it. So we said, all right, now each read can only support a single assembly, so once you incorporate a read into a contig, we can remove it from our graph. And that solved the first problem, but we ran into a different problem. We actually generated, say, our windows, this big window over here, there's our reads mapping. We generated contigs that kind of looked like this, that went from the blue to the red. Oh, look, there's a repeat here, and then we went into the yellow. And so now this looks like there's a deletion of the green and one copy of the red, but in your actual data, in your data itself, there's actually no support for that. So we ended up having problems with having misassembly or no assembly in the windows where there was actually repeats. So in our third attempt, we went, all right, our standard assembly techniques are not going to work. We need to develop some sort of specialized breakpoint assembly algorithm. So what we want to do is we want to assemble the reads together, but we only want to assemble reads that all support, mutually provide support for the same putative breakpoint in there. So I thought about this for a while, and I developed a new assembly algorithm based on a new data structure similar to the standard de Bruijn graph assembly, which I called the positional de Bruijn graph. And then after a lit review, I found someone had already made a positional de Bruijn graph, but in a different context. So, all right, so I'll give you some background on how de Bruijn graph assembly works. So you have a read from your sequencer, and then the concept here is you break your read up into smaller sequences of a fixed length. In this case, they're all going to be four base pairs long. And you generate a graph of the adjacencies between all these four base pairs. So if you move along the read, well, those four bases are actually follow on from those previous, because there's an overlap of three. And following on your whole read, chop up. Then you add another read, then you chop that into first four bases. And if you look at the first four bases of that, it actually has overlap with the other. So you end up being able to connect these reads by these smaller common or sequences known as chimers. In this case, k equals 4. And then you add more, and if you have, say, sequencing errors or base differences in the reads, such as this T not matching this A, you end up with little kind of branches and bubbles in the graph. And now, each of these paths in the graph, you can follow the path along the graph, and that actually generates you a longer contig out of it, so your longer synthetic read. That was our traditional assembly algorithm. That wasn't working. So we solved a problem where we have reads that map to different locations to being assembled together, we said, all right, let's actually add more information to this graph. Instead of just having the read sequence there, we say we want the read sequence and the position we expect this chimer sequence to actually align at. So I'll give you an example of how this works. So say we have couple of soft clip reads and some discordant reads that map weirdly. Take our first read, chop it up into chimers, a chimer size is 4 in this example, and then say, all right, where are these chimers mapped, aligned to the reference in this read we came from? Well, the first one's at position 10 and the next one's at position 11, so let's add that to our new graph, which has our position and our chimer. Our discordant read pairs are a little more complicated. So this one's mapped here. If we had this read, if this was to actually come from a fragment spanning a breakpoint, we would expect the fragment size to be somewhere around this size based on our fragment length distribution. So we could actually place this mate at any number and at multiple possible positions given the alignment of the anchored read. So we just add it to our graph at every possible position. In this case, we have 3. In real data, you'll probably have 100 or 200 or 300 possible positions. And then we do that for the rest of it, and then we end up a graph like this. So instead of having a single sequence merged up, we have multiple sets of sequences based on the possible position that these sequences occur. From here, we identify the paths that give the greatest support, so supported by the most reads. In this case, it's this one. And then we go from our contig, and we can just read this contig straight back off. It starts at position 10. Look, that's what our contig is. The first 6 bases match, which we expect, because the first 6 bases match here. And then we have this nice new sequence over here. Then we already know where one part of it is mapped to. Then all we need to do is map these remaining bases elsewhere in the genome. And then we say, all right, here we go. Now we've combined our reads, and which is showing there's a deletion of bases 16 to 43 of our reference. So having generated these contigs and done our assembly, we now need to combine the assembly, that is, if we could get the assembly, with the actual discordant read pairs and the split read evidence, because sometimes your coverage isn't big enough to actually get assembly, or you just don't have reads that overlap. So to combine those evidence, we say, all right, let's look at everything, look at the range of possible breakpoint positions that these reads or assemblies support, and take all the possible sets. And so in this case, we have this position going to this position overlapped by the first 2 pairs as well as the split read. But there's also this window out here supported by 2 and 3. So we have 2 possible interpretations of this. So we have 2 different variants. So to solve this problem, because that discordant pair number 2 there, that's come from a fragment. That fragment can't support 2 different structural variations. It's come from a single fragment in your source library. So we only want to assign it to 1 variant. So the way we do that is we just look at all the variants, and whichever one scores the highest, that's where we assign it. So we just remove it from that second variant. But to do that, we need some sort of scoring mechanism that combines the split read and the discordant read pair and the assembly, so we can know which one scores the actual best. So the way we scored our reads is we score the reads based on the likelihood of these reads occurring in our input library. So if you have a fragment size distribution like that on the left, if you have a really long fragment or your reads are mapping to different chromosomes, that's quite unexpected. Whereas if it's only just a little bit big or a little bit short, then that doesn't carry as much weight, because that actually just could have come from a long or a short fragment. Similarly, if you have a short soft clip, there's lots of short soft clips. They could be alignment artifacts. They're usually alignment artifacts. But if you have something that's a long soft clip, there's not many of those that have been that mapped in your input data, so we'll consider that stronger evidence. So we put all these together, and we base and we give each read assembly a score. We can also combine that with the read mapping quality, because the aligners actually give you a mapping quality score. So if it places a read and there's, say, 100 different locations that the read can map to, it will give it a very low mapping quality score. But if it places a read and says, yes, I'm extremely confident that this read is here and only here, then that is much stronger evidence for a structural variation or a genomic rearrangement, because if the aligner just placed it in one of 100 possible locations, it's probably not that location that it placed it, which is the actual variant. So essentially, the more unexpected the read, the higher we score it. So combining our assembly and our variant scoring, read extraction. So really, did we improve? That's the next question. So we tested our method. We tested it on simulated data. We tested it on extensively validated cell line data. We had our competition that Tony mentioned, and then we actually applied this to real data in the lab to solve some interesting issues. So For our simulated data, we simulated a whole bunch of insertions, deletion, tandem duplications, inversions, arbitrary fusions. For grids itself, we tested it on a really wide range of input data. We tested from read lengths based from 36 base pairs to 250 base pairs. We went from library fragment sizes with a mean inserts, libraries with mean fragment size of 150 base pairs to 500 base pairs. We changed different read depths. We used 5 different aligners to test this. So overall, we tested a bit over on 16 million variants for grids. Now, to compare to the others, we took the representative subset that's most, which is most typical of sequencing that happens now, and we compared it to some callers that use discordant read pairs, some that use split read evidence, some that combine the two, and ended up. So this is kind of the typical result from the simulation. So on our x-axis, we have our false positives. On our y-axis, we have our simulation. Now, your ideal caller sits up in the top left-hand corner. It gets every single event that that's actually there, and it doesn't call any false positives. Now, as you can see, grids being the red line is actually closest to the top left. So our high confidence call set up here gives us the highest sensitivity for the lowest false positive rate. But if you need even higher sensitivity, well, we move across here and we can say, all right, there's our low conf. So this is essentially this is the call set we would give to clinicians. This is the ones we would look for if we had prior evidence. Or for example, if there was a transgene and you knew there should be some sort of breakpoint or variant here, because that's where that's part of a vector, then you would look for that within your low confidence. So some callers performed quite poorly. So Pindell, an example here, performed pretty terribly. That's actually expected because Pindell wasn't designed to call arbitrary fusions. Some were somewhat unexpected in their performance, so Breakdancer actually performed quite poorly. Breakdancer is one of the older algorithms that was actually designed for 36 base pair, 50 base pair reads, and that actually performs relatively poorly as you get longer read lengths. But overall, we found the simulation didn't actually tell us a lot because, honestly, it's kind of a bit easy of a test. I needed to use a non-linear scale on your sensitivity to even actually show that these things are different. So a much better, more accurate representation of performance is to actually test it on real data. So we tested it on the genome in a bottle cell line data, which is probably the most sequenced individual in the world. And for our truth, we wanted confirmation with long reads, and we had PacBio and Moleculo, or now known as TrueSec, reads available for validation. We only compared deletions because that gave us a baseline that all the callers that we were comparing to were able to detect. And so what did we find? Slight difference here, since we don't actually know the number of true variants, we've got true positives instead of sensitivity on the y-axis. We've got false positives on the x-axis here. And this is basically my PhD in a nutshell. You have all these callers kind of overlapping, similar, depending on where on your ROC curve you're looking at. You'll have one caller that's better than the others, and it's not completely clear-cut who's the best, except when you add ours to the mix. And then there's a clear separation between us and everything else. If you look at the first 1,000 events or first 1,500 events, we have less than half the false discovery rate of any of the other callers. So the reason we are doing better is because of what we did earlier with our assembly strategy. We incorporated these soft clip reads or the unmapped reads and all these extra reads into our assembly process itself, which we then used in our variant calling to inform our variant calls themselves instead of, for example, as assembly as kind of some sort of validation step, and that massively improved our processing. Now, you might say this comparison is unfair. I ran these callers with the default settings or the settings recommended according to their user guide. So maybe you could have tuned these other callers to do better than they actually do here. So then I would say, well, our next result that Tony's already spoiled was the competition that we did, where we had the ICGC Dream Somatic Mutation Calling Challenge, where you actually have, you can download the data, run your analysis, submit your variant calls, and they'll tell you what's your true positive, false positive rate. And so that's been going since 2003, well before GRIDS was written. So we submitted to challenge number 5 and we placed first, yay. We also did a backdated submission to challenge number 4 and we would have won that as well if we'd entered. So essentially, yes. In the simulated data, we do better, but when compared to others who are submitting the best results they can get from that tool, including any manual curation they want to do, our output from our tool did better, even without having to do any curation. So that's all very well and good. So what have we actually managed to do with this to actually, in terms of actual applications within the lab. As Tony said, our first application was to our cancer neochromosomes, where these kind of Cirkhoff's plots are from a manually curated call set, or at least the 778 was heavily curated, where to generate these plots, since this was done this sequencing was done some time ago, the lab developed a bespoke read pair-based method and then added some filtering calls. So then we went, all right, we'll take these calls, let's refine these calls using GRIDS. So what do we find? Well, when we ran GRIDS, we had 98% concordance with the manually curated call set. So we got pretty much the same results. 96.5% were high confidence calls, so we're quite happy with those. Well, interesting, what we managed to find was we found 64 of the events that were actually compound fusions. So the read pair based method, so your fusion would kind of look like this, which was A to B to C. You would have, since the B fragment was relatively small, the read pair would say, oh, A and C are connected. So when we ran our GRIDS and we had our assembly and we could span multiple breakpoints and identify them all, we were actually able to identify that it's not actually an A to C fusion, it's actually an A to B to C fusion. On top of that, we're able to identify an extra 274 additional fusions that were actually below the threshold. So the initial analysis was done, set a threshold, and said if there's 7 read pairs or fewer, or sorry, if it's fewer than 7 read pairs, then we're going to chuck it out as not enough support. What GRIDS managed to do is actually essentially rescue those by combining the discordant read pairs, the unmapped mate, the soft clips, with the assembly and say, all right, these ones, that there's actually not a lot of coverage compared to the others, but I actually got some good quality assemblies from one side to the other and from the other side back again, then that's probably real. And that's very cool. So we managed to actually extend our call set. Interestingly, since we get base pair accurate calls, we were able to actually look at the actual breakpoints and found that there was only actually 26% of these breakpoints that were straight clean breaks from one to the other. Most of them were at some sort of microhomology that gives some strong hints about what sort of DNA repair pathway was involved in actually making these, and in about 10% of those, there was actually additional bases inserted in there. Now, in the case of this 10%, some of them are of this form, that since this B fragment was too short, GRIDS wasn't able to identify where in the genome it came from. If you've only got 10 or 15 bases or 20 bases, you can't actually say where it came from. Another used in the lab is transgenic organism validation. So this is work done by Jan, where we had a EU-MYC transgene. This is in a mouse model in a PUC12 vector. And Jan actually did this work a few years ago with Socrates, which was a split read based caller that was developed in the lab. And of all the breakpoints, Socrates, when he compared to the other callers, was able to detect them where the other callers couldn't detect them all. What was interesting about this fire hex, when the initial analysis was done, that wasn't actually added to the reference. So when they did the alignment, nothing aligned to phi x because phi x wasn't actually added in there. So none of the callers got the phi x, which you'd expect. But interestingly, GRIDS was actually able to manage to construct nice, high-quality, long assemblies and said, well, there's some sort of insertion here at both D and E. I can tell there's something there. Doesn't map to the reference, but there is something there. And then you blast it back and you find, oh, it's phi x. Then I asked Tony and he said, oh, yeah, there's phi x in there, of course. But that's a nice demonstration of the power of GRIDS, that even if you don't have something in the reference, GRIDS will tell you, actually, there's something here. I can't tell, but the construct isn't exactly what you said it, what we expected it to be. In this case, it actually was. More recently, we've done some validation of malaria vaccine candidates, looking at the mutations used to generate the candidates. From a clinical perspective, a nice little application of GRIDS that I quite like, this was work run by Alex, was used in generating personalized cancer biomarkers. So the idea behind this study was you take a tumor biopsy and you sequence the tumor biopsy, and then you use that biopsy to find patient-specific biomarkers that you can use in the circulating cell-free DNA. So the idea here is 35 times sequencing of the tumor, which is kind of lowish, but it's all right, and then feed it to GRIDS. GRID says, here's all the breakpoints. We do some manual curation to remove the stuff that we think looks germline. And then we take those breakpoints, hand them over to Hong Do, and who designs patient-specific primers across those breakpoints. And so that's a nice... For the 10 breakpoints we actually sent for... primer generation, they designed primers from 8, some of them have an issue. 6 of those were somatic, 2 were germline, so all of them were real events. So all the calls that GRIDS said, yes, here is something, I have high confidence of this, they are actually real, but in our curation, in our guesstimation of is this is germline or not, we got 2 of those guesses wrong. So the output of this is... have a set of primers designed, and then you just use digital droplet PCR to actually monitor your tumor burden after you've done your biopsy to actually look for signs of relapse. And that's quite nice because it gives you an extremely sensitive and extremely specific biomarker test. Now, just a few closing remarks. With a background of software engineering, I'm kind of biased. I think software engineering is important. Reliability and testing of software is really important. GRIDS has over 1,200 automated test cases that run every time. Usability is important, both performance and error handling. Like, if you're going to crash, at least tell the user what they can do about it, if it was because they entered the wrong file name or something. And documentation, showing what you actually do, is important. Not on the slides, but standards are important. If you're going to write software, at least write file formats that everything else has used, so your users don't have to keep writing parsers to convert from one format to another. So, in conclusion, developed a new software, new structural variant caller that makes a better use of the available evidence. The key to that was our alignment-guided whole genome assembly algorithm And it's this approach that sets GRIDS apart from all the other callers. What to do from here? GRIDS currently is fundamentally, it's a breakpoint caller. It just calls breakpoint. So if we incorporate copy number into the set of breakpoint calls, then we can do some more analysis about, we can give better information about, for example, is this actually a deletion? Got some capture sequencing, exome sequencing with, for example, some tiled introns at Peter Mac that we have some promising data. When we run GRIDS on that, we can, for example, detect ALK EML4 fusions from captured sequencing, which is quite nice. I'm going to further analyze the neochromosomes to try and uncover more about their mechanisms of formation and evolution. And the rest is all acknowledgements. We have Tony and my committee, the Papenfuss lab, everyone who has helped with me, including Vincent, Ismail, Amit and John, who had to deal with early versions of GRID that had very, very poor documentation. The clinical stuff I've done with Alex at the Olivia Newton-John Cancer Research Centre, with the neochromosome stuff with Andrews. Thanks for listening. Any questions?
Grids on any samples where you would expect an integrating oncovirus, and do you expect grids to be good at detecting those sorts of events?
In terms of viral insertion, the PhD initially started as a viral insertion project, and what I wanted to do was there's at least three different tools out there to detect viral insertions, but all of those tools required you to know the viral sequence beforehand, and then it essentially just looks for a signal from the reference genome into the viral sequence. So one of the driving forces behind eventually what turned into grids was to say, all right, I want to be able to detect this without actually knowing the viral sequence. And I think the PhiX example is a good example of that, where we had an integration of some sort of sequence. We didn't know that sequence. It wasn't in the reference, but we were able to determine that there was a sequence of something there, and we got like 200-300 bases of sequence, which we then blasted back and go, oh, it's our PhiX construct. So yes, you should be able to detect it. It'll be much better if you have your viral sequence as part of your reference, because that makes it a lot easier. But we do have examples where we can do that sort of viral integration detection.
How does your software handle the heterogeneity that is present in the cancer sample? So you could have a mixture of cells. Some have a certain breakpoint,
yep.
Others don't. So what do you get there?
In there, well, since we're just chucking out everything that doesn't have breakpoints and looks clean on the reference, what you'll see is you'll just see the breakpoint, but in terms of the allele frequency between the number of reads supporting the variant and those supporting the reference will be lower than if it was, say, a homozygous breakpoint. That analysis is actually left for downstream. As part of the output of the program, I actually give breakdowns of all these counts, how many discordant reads, how many split reads, how many reads went into an assembly that would support the breakpoint, and I also output how many actually support no breakpoint across this position, so you could use that to determine it. If your allele frequency is too low, and so, for example, you have very low cellularity of the cells with the breakpoint, then you may not be able to detect it, or more likely it'll just be a low confidence call that just gets lost in the noise.
What's written in, and how fast is it?
It is written in Java with callouts to C for the bits that actually get slow. In terms of speed, it's kind of middle of the range of the various callers, so it's about 3 times slower than Socrates or Breakdancer. It's about the same speed as Deli and Lumpy, but it's about 10 times faster than Pindel. So middle of the pack, which I think is pretty good considering the extra work that the program does compared to the other callers. So you expect a whole genome sequencing in probably 4 hours processing on there, so 3-4 hours. Karen.
Often you'd want to find a protein at the end of these rearrangements. Can you compare it to how close RNA-seq does over
there? Yes, you can do it, but I currently just output what the breakpoint is, so that would be left to downstream analysis. So from the output of grids, you can construct exactly what it is. In fact, for the malaria vaccine stuff that we did, I personally quite liked that, because in the reference we had a human gene in there, and the we had the processed gene in the construct, but the reference was just the straight human reference, and grids actually called exon, 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 oh, back out, back in, into plasmodium. So, yes, it can detect that. It makes it a little more difficult, but yeah, we can do exon, exon jumps and detection, even for small, say, 50, 60 base pair exons.
You've talked a lot about application in cancer space, but what about just improvements of the human reference genome? Is there some ability to... Are you seeing these same types of events where a complex rearrangement in the human genome has been misannotated, or is there some ability there?
Yes, there is some ability there, but I don't have the contacts to actually get into that. The challenge that I was talking about, they were actually going to reanalyze all the like thousands and thousands of cancer samples, at least from the high scoring tools, as a result of that challenge. So it may get some application there, but I personally am not involved in it. Ideally, in my scenario, people would look at grids, say, yes, this is really good, and everyone just would start using it, and then it would be a new standard. And then everyone would make derivative programs with minor improvements along it, which is what they've been doing, same techniques. One more?
Sorry, related to that question, what would be your estimate of the number of rearrangements between any two germline genomes? Or any germline and
reserve? In terms of total number of
rearrangements?
Well, probably the best slide for that would be this slide, where we have, this actually is a germline sequence. So here you're just looking at the total number of deletions. There's a few more insertions. There's some structural stuff with alternate assemblies in there, which you can, do you class them as a actual variant or not? So you're a few thousand in terms of deletions, probably similar number for insertions and inversions.
Okay. Let's just thank Daniel for a really animated and interesting talk.